It's about a whole lot more than that. Both of them have been saved, and this morning they're going to be baptized because we had financial peace available. How cool is that? Thursday, May 2nd, then, and we'll talk more about this as it gets closer, we're going to have a National Day of Prayer. And it's my hope that the church is going to be open all day long into the evening, and we can come just whenever we can and pray for different things. We'll have a board up there, a government, all kinds of different things. And we can pray through them and be a nation, one nation under God, maybe, for just one day in prayer. And that's all of our announcements that I know of, unless anybody has something else. I'll try and talk loud this morning. I know we've got a lot of background noise, and we'll try to keep it quick. Next, accepting Jesus. I think baptism is one of the most important things we do in our church culture. It was something that Jesus commanded to go in Matthew 28 before he ascended to be with the Father in heaven forever. He said, go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And that was an important command. Of all the things for Jesus to say before he left, he gave us that command to go and make disciples and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and then teach them everything that I've taught you. So it was a pretty important command that he gave in the beginning. I wrote down, it seals our faith walk with Jesus. Scripture talks about it being a seal in Matthew. Jesus saw it was important, and he set the example for us by his baptism. And that's what I'd like to read to us right now. It's in Matthew 3, and it's 13 through 17. John the Baptist starts in verse 11. It says, I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not fit to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn, and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And then in verse 13, it says, then Jesus came from Galilee to Jordan to be baptized by John. And I thought how important that is. It says he came. That is something that we intentionally set out to do. John had no idea that Jesus was coming to be baptized, but Jesus made up his mind, I'm intentionally going to go where John the Baptist is and be baptized. And that's what these people that have come this morning to be baptized have done. They have intentionally come here to make their commitment in front of all of you as witnesses. It says, but John tried to deter him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me? And it's funny, we've got witnesses, several of the people this morning that are here to be baptized, and people question their ability or their holiness or their righteousness to be baptized this morning. Whenever we set out to serve the Lord and get closer to Him, Satan would love to kill, steal, and destroy that. And there are a couple testimonies here this morning where they've been approached this week and told that they were not worthy or ready for baptism. And John did that to Jesus, and we know why that happened, because John knew who Jesus was. And he said, I'm not worthy to do that for you. But Jesus replied, let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness. And doing our baptism like we're going to do this morning, Jesus told John, that fulfills righteousness. There's a part of us that get to the place where we need to just feel in our spirit that we need to do something to show Jesus that we're fully committed. And that's what this baptism does, is to fulfill all righteousness. And then John consented. He said, okay, Jesus, if you feel that way, I'm going to go ahead and do this. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. Now there's another key phrase, up out of the water. So many of us in here have come from Lutheran and Methodist backgrounds, and we were sprinkled as babies. And I'm not saying that was wrong, it was useless, it was stupid. That is not the case at all. But what I am saying is Destiny Family of Faith believes in immersion for baptism. And we've got a couple people here today that were sprinkled as children, and they're going to get baptized now because they've accepted Jesus and they know what it fully means now. So Jesus came up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I love, with him I am well pleased. And when we get up out of that water today, these people that are going to be baptized today, the Lord is going to look down on you just like he did with Jesus and say, this is my child with whom I'm well pleased. It's really awesome what's going to take place this morning. Baptism indicated that Jesus was consecrated or set apart for God. That was its whole purpose. It indicates God approves of him. He said, this is my Son with whom I'm well pleased. And that's why we talk to the communicants and make sure they know Jesus. They understand why they're being baptized. And baptism is a reminder of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. That's what we do when we get into the water. We're dying to ourselves. We're stepping in to the water, admitting that we're in self-denial. We're gonna die to ourselves. And then the guys are going to dip them under the water as a burial and then lift them up as a resurrection. Old things are going to stay in that water. And when they come up, all things are going to become brand new. It's really a neat symbol. Jesus' baptism was an example to his followers. I think that's a cool point. When Jesus went to John and said, I want to be baptized, and you're going to do it. What an example. That's an example that he wants us all to be baptized. And we've got a teaching that's been going around for thousands of years, a couple thousand years, that if you're not baptized, you're not saved. And I want you to hear what I'm going to tell you right now. Only the blood of Jesus saves. Did you hear me? Say amen. Amen. Baptism does not save you. If it did, all we had to do was go swimming and come out a new creation. And that's not the case. It took the Lord to send his one and only Son to die for us. It's the blood of Jesus that saves us. Are we with that? Does everybody understand? Baptism shows outwardly of an inwardly change. And that's why it's so important for us to baptize, to immerse when we're older and understand why we're doing baptism. Because God changes us from the inside out when we accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. And we're committing a symbol down here, an act, an obedience that says that my heart's been changed. I want to follow Jesus as Lord and Savior. And I'm doing this next step to commit my life to Him. Our heart change is the difference. You and I can look different on the outside, but if we're not different on the inside, we're the same old self, and we're going to do the same things over and over, expecting a different outcome, and it won't happen. Some of us here have been taught that baptism saves. It's not true, and I already explained that. Jesus never requires more of us than he does any other believer. In the Old Testament, people were not baptized. None of them were baptized. And a lot of them were circumcised, and then he addresses that too, that it wasn't the circumcision that saved. It was the heart change. It was the faith that followed God Almighty. That was the most important thing that happened. Our baptism is a personal testimony. I love it. I remember when I was baptized, and nobody can take that away. Nobody can change it. When I talk to different people and tell them about my baptism, no one can argue how that affected me and how it permanently changed my life. So it's a personal testimony, and all of us need to be prepared to give an answer for the hope we have in Jesus. And our baptism's part of that preparation. We immerse because the original Greek word baptizo means to dip or immerse. And we got in a church culture in the 2nd, 3rd century where they were in the desert, they had no water, they even sprinkled with sand at times for baptism. And there wasn't a lot of water at times, and if they found water, it was really yucky, and they didn't want to use it. So they would purify some water and sprinkle it. And that 2nd and 3rd century church started adopting sprinkling as a norm. Well, then when they got ready to translate the Bible, here we have a church culture that's about 90% sprinkling, and they wanted to go back to the original Greek and do it like it was original, the baptizo. Baptizo means to immerse or dip. And they said, we'll use the word baptism. That means to wash or clean. And that way we won't offend everybody. I don't know if any of you in here much have studied the Anabaptists, but the Anabaptists were persecuted after the 3rd century because they started immersing again. And it was so serious, that teaching of sprinkling, that they were killing people because they immersed underwater. So the word we use, baptism, today means to wash or clean. And that's why I wanted to point out to you, the only thing that washes us clean as white as snow is what? The blood of Jesus. So that theory, that's why baptism is used in our culture today. And I'll close with this. I want to go to Acts 8. We have a really neat story of baptism here. It was Philip and the Ethiopian. And it's in Acts 8, 28, or starts in verse 26. It says, now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. So he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship. That's an important phrase because here we have a eunuch that is not a Jew, and he went to Jerusalem to worship. So this guy had some knowledge of God Almighty, and he went to Jerusalem to worship. And he probably heard some cool words and cool teaching there. And on his way back home, was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, go to the chariot and stay near. And I thought how cool that is. Here we've got the Spirit involved in this situation, just like when Jesus went and the Spirit descended upon him. Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. Do you understand what you're reading? Philip asked. And he said, how can I, he said, unless someone explains it to me. How cool it is. God Almighty knew this eunuch was going to have a question about what was ready to happen, and he sent Philip there to answer the questions. The Holy Spirit is now our comforter, our source, and we can rely on Him anytime we need to ask, what does this mean, Lord? So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. The eunuch was reading this passage of Scripture. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. And the eunuch asked Philip, tell me, please, who is this prophet talking about, himself or someone else? And then Philip began with the very passage of Scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. It was Jesus that the eunuch was reading about, how he died and was resurrected for us. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, look, here's water. Why shouldn't I be baptized? Now the eunuch brought it up. He had an intentionality just like Jesus did when he came to be baptized. And that's the way with the people here to be baptized this morning. They have come and asked, why can't I be baptized? And we said, well, you sure can. I had, I don't know, 7 or 8 people say they wanted to be baptized. And God only knows how many are going to end up getting baptized this morning. It's going to be neat. But he said, why shouldn't I be baptized? And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized them. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way rejoicing. What a cool story of baptism there. And what I want to bring out, the eunuch went and worshiped. It caused him to have questions. They were answered by the Lord, the Holy Spirit, and he was baptized. So that is why we go through the sequence of leading somebody to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, discipling them, and then having them ask, can I be baptized? And then we do it by immersion, so they go into the water and come up out of it. Is everybody okay with that? That's why we do at Destiny Family of Faith what we do. And now we're going to do it. This is the cool part. If you're going to be baptized, why don't you come over in this area over here? And we'll start the baptism. The worship team's going to sing a song here that's really cool while they're coming over to be baptized. Everybody come over on this side. And anybody that feels the urge to be baptized, you get the water right now. Don't wait. Be obedient.
Same man. God, I'll try. just want it to end.
God, I'll try to make sense. I see my way into that place. Your soul's getting lost, lines getting crossed, they won't go away. In my knees, and here I stand. There I was.
Change for the better, more smiles, less bitter. Feet have started to forget myself. In my knees, but here I stand. There I was, but here I am. In my knees, but here I stand.
Thank you.
Don't worry, Bob. You're going to get wet again. Just worry about me again.
It's been like 18 years since I've been here. I'm done.
This is one of the reasons we started the family faith, for this kind of thing to happen, this kind of testimony to come out of nothing. David, we're going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Beth, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Next, Joe, you might as well follow your wife, buddy. Thank you. That's all right. You, I knew you did it on purpose. Who's next? Are you limping?
Amen.
This bald head guy down here in the pool is our youth pastor. And he was over to Alabama running the studio, and it was for kids in the Alabama area there to come to and to learn and grow and know Jesus. And we teamed up with him. The Lord only knows how we got to him. Destiny got going over there to help him. And we were ready to do some really neat stuff. And all of a sudden, they fell naming God from here. And I asked him, would you please consider coming to Destiny and being our youth pastor? And I said, it pays really awesome. It pays what they pay me, nothing. And he looked at me and he says, I want to do it. And him and Tanya, thank you so much, Tanya. Me and Tanya have been working with the youth and we're building a youth department up. And what is so funny about all that, Angie, her daughter and son have got this group of kids that they know all over the world. That's what we bought the van for. The first night she pulls in, there's 14 kids in the van. Guess where Angie lives? Alabama. You know what? We can take the job away. Can't take the Holy Spirit away. He's busting those kids in from Alabama to Dayton County all over again. How cool is that?
Baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Children's home that we just learned from where my teacher's
She's almost baptized when she gets in. Well, Brianna, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Keely, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. right here.